The geeky math thing to notice for this week is that all the dates this week are palindromes. 41514. Convolution integral. So here's the symbol for convolution. If we have F convoluted with G, and really that's just a shift in one of the functions. We put this one in terms of tau. We shift this one by tau. And we integrate with respect to tau. It doesn't really matter which function you choose to shift. If you prefer, you could have written it f of t minus tau and left g in terms of tau. Either one will give you the same answer. And your limits of integration on both of these are from 0 to t. So it doesn't matter which one you shift. If you do the Laplace transform of a convolution, bless you. Then you get the Laplace transforms separately and take their product. But that's only true for convolution, not for multiplication. It's incorrect to say that if I multiply two functions together, then I can just multiply their Laplace transforms. There's always a shift involved. All right, look on page 303, and let's just play around with this convolution a little bit. On number 2, they give you that f of t is t. And g of t is e to the at. So, convolution of f with g. Here's what the integral would look like. Now, I shifted on e to the at. You could shift on t if you wanted to. Well, I left my t alone, and I did my shift here. And the reason that I did that is I can break up that exponent. I have an exponent rule that says if I wanted to, I could rewrite this as e to the at and then e to the negative a tau. Because our rule was if I multiply two things that have the same base, then I add their exponents. So I'm just using that rule in reverse here. And since I'm only integrating with respect to tau, that means my e to the at can come out. So this would become e to the at. And then tau e to the negative a tau. And that I can integrate by parts. What should we let u equal? How do we decide?
Something that's gonna end up going to zero after numerous trips.
Or gets, at least gets easier. May not necessarily have to go to zero, but I like U to be something that when I take its derivative, it gets a little bit easier. And what do I like for DV to be?
Something you're gonna integrate easily.
Something I know how to integrate. Maybe not easily, but at least I know how to integrate it.
So I'm gonna let U equal tau, and I'm gonna let DV be E to the negative A tau. D tau. So DU would just be D tau. And B, if we integrate, what do we get?
Negative tau E.
Well, tau is the variable.
Negative 1 over A.
Negative 1 over A. E to the negative A tau. If you took a derivative, it would be A. If you integrate, it's 1 over A. Okay, so we remember you do UV minus V DU. So UV is going to be negative tau over A E to the negative A tau. And there we're going from 0 to T. Minus the integral V DU, but V was negative, so instead of a minus, we're going to have a plus here. And V was, let's pull our 1 over A outside. And just make this E to the negative A tau. And we know we can integrate that because we just did a minute ago. So we're going to end up here with e to the at. Here's this again. And then this one's going to integrate to negative 1 over a squared e to the negative a tau. All right, let's put in our limits. When we put in a T, then the tau just becomes a T. So this is going to be negative T over A, E to the negative A T. And this is going to become a negative 1 over A squared, E to the negative A T. And then when we put in our lower limit of 0, what's going to happen to that tau over A?
Go to
0. That's going to go to 0. So we'd have a plus 0 here because it's minus a negative. And then that lower limit would be minus a negative 1 over A squared. And then E to the 0 would just be 1, right? Mm-hmm. So this becomes negative T over A. Minus 1 over a squared plus 1 over a squared e to the at. Any questions about that integral we just did? Now, we could have worked it this way. Let me show you another way we could have gotten the same answer. Remember that I told you the Laplace of a convolution is just the product of the separate Laplace transforms. So I take the Laplace of F multiplied by the Laplace of G. So our f of t for this problem was t. What's the Laplace transform of t? 1 over s squared. You can get that out of your table. Even on test day, you can get that out of your table. All right, our g of t was e to the at. So what is its Laplace transform?
1 over s minus a.
1 over s minus a. So if I were to take the Laplace of t e to the at, I would end up with 1 over s squared times 1 over s minus a, according to this theorem. If I take that and break it up, then I would have a over s, b over s squared, and c over s minus a, right? If I use partial fraction. Of course, we'll multiply this by s squared times s minus a. So we end up with a 1 over here. The a gets multiplied by s and s minus a. The b only gets multiplied by s minus a. And the c gets multiplied by s squared. So we would have as squared minus AAS plus BS minus, plus BA, no, minus BA, minus, plus CS squared. So let's write our equations over here. What do we have with S squared?
A plus
C. Is there an S squared on the left side?
No,
so what does that have to equal?
Zero.
Zero. Okay, with s, we have a negative a times little a. And then we have a b, right? Is there an s on the other side? No, so that's zero also. And then we just have a negative b a here. And what would that have to equal? Because that's your constant. That'd have to equal 1. So that tells me that B is going to be negative 1 over A. If B is negative 1 over A, then negative A times A minus 1 over A will equal 0. So A is going to be negative 1 over A squared. And if A and C have to add to 0, what does that tell you C will be?
1 over A squared.
Positive 1 over A squared. Okay, so we'll come back over here then. And we know that the Laplace can be rewritten is negative 1 over a squared over s minus 1 over a over s squared plus 1 over a squared times s minus a. And so what would our function end up being? Let's don't call it f, because we already had an f and a g. We'll call this one h. So take the inverse Laplace of a constant over s. What do you get? What's the inverse Laplace of 1 over s? 1. So I would just multiply by this constant. So I get 1 over a squared. What's the Laplace of 1 over s squared? So this would be minus t over a. And then what's the Laplace of 1 over s minus a? E to the at. So this would be plus 1 over a squared e to the at. Is that the same answer that we got when we did it using the convolution integral? So we haven't proven the convolution interval, but we have verified that in this particular case, I get the same function. Okay, so here's what we're going to do with this. Because really, the next question is, Ms. Hudson, why do we have to learn this? Right? Is that the next question? Why do we need to know this?